The Pacific Inquiry wasn't planned. It wasn't something I had envisioned at all, you know. But when I came into the role, I heard about this thing called the ethnic pay gap.
In 2018, Dr. Karinina Sumeo became the Equal Employment Opportunities Commissioner for the Human Rights Commission.
The public service releases this annual workforce where they report on the data, and the data that I saw pointed directly to Pacific people being at the bottom for at least the last 10 years. I felt insulted and disrespected as a Pacific person in the public service of all places. I thought, well, this could be happening right across the country.
Dr. Sumeo found the national pay gap looks like this. On average, after working a 40-hour week, a Pākehā man earns $1,442. A Pākehā woman earns $1,351, while a Pacific man earns $1,090, and a Pacific woman, $1,049. That is $393 less than a Pākehā man.
And I thought, this is a huge injustice. We need to understand why this is happening.
Dr. Sumeo launched the Pacific Pay Gap Inquiry in 2020. It analyses workforce data, reviews literature, and speaks with Pacific workers.
Some of the stories that people share with us, that's the first time that they've ever shared that story with someone who isn't, you know, perhaps their husband or wife, and they're often deeply distressed by what they've experienced.
The inquiry put out a report in July which analysed possible causes for the gap.
We heard from CEOs, people in manufacturing, we heard from engineers, just kind of like right across the board. We talked to over 1,200 Pacific people. We've done all kinds of research with numbers, and that actually the large majority of the Pacific pay gap cannot be explained by education or even industry.
Discrimination and bias are identified as possible causes.
But our people were talking about racism when they've got the same qualification, they've proven their worth, some of them being leading teams and projects and still being paid less. And it's not about education, it's not about occupational choice, it's not about lack of commitment or lack of performance.
Saunoamaali’i has first-hand experience of the Pacific pay gap. She discovered her pay gap while working in a public service role that involved assessing pay scales.
And I noticed that my role was in there, but there was a very similar role, very, very similar, apart from the title being different, that wasn't there. So just innocently, I asked my boss, where's the other role? And they said, oh, that's on a management role, it's on a different scale. Well, why isn't my role on that scale? It's the same role.
The Pacific pay gap happens in two ways. One is where a Pacific person is paid less for the same role. The other is where Pacific people are funneled into particular roles or excluded from opportunities and promotions.
I would walk into a distribution centre in South Auckland. 99% of the floor staff would be brown, largely Māori and Pacific, and you know, some other ethnic minorities. And most of the management above a team leader would be Pākehā. And so you could just see it.
When Dr. Seriana Neapi noticed a shortage of Māori and Pacific teaching staff, she researched universities using a national data set that included academic grades.
Not only were there not many of us, but when we did make it to the top of our field, we were facing a significant pay gap compared to our Pākehā counterparts, despite being just as excellent.
When her research was released, she found out she was part of the statistics.
I only know that I faced a pay gap because a Pākehā colleague of mine told me how much she was on, and we compared CVs and went, hang on, this doesn't make sense. There have been moments on this journey around the pay gap where I've been in tears. There's a difference between intellectually knowing that there's a pay gap and knowing that it impacts you. And I think that that's the piece that we have to work out how to respond.
For Saunoamaali’i, the conversation with her manager resulted in her pay gap being corrected.
Didn't occur to me at the time that there might be some risks. I was too angry. But I have to say also at that time, I mean, you know, we own our own house, so I wasn't worried that if I ever lost my job, there'd be no food or we can't. So I had that security behind me. We need to take the onus away from people who are suffering inequity and put it back on the businesses who know every week who's being paid what and can see the inequities themselves.
The inquiry report coming out in September will recommend actions the government and employers can take to solve the Pacific pay gap.
The hope piece, I think, is the inquiry. Because the inquiry is getting people talking about it, is recording the numbers, is recording the stories, it's a lot harder to avoid public pressure for change.
I think pay transparency, undoubtedly, being legislated for is what will get the broadest results.
I'm still hoping that before the end of the term of this government, that they will enact appropriate laws to enable pay transparency to happen. We're a Pacific nation, for goodness sake. You know, we're supposed to be a champion for Pacific. We can't let this lie and let it dwindle on to the next generation. We have an opportunity.